KPFA-WBR in Santa Cruz and online at kpfa.org. Please stay tuned for About Health.
Good morning and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenoir. A very special edition of About Health today. Our guest is Dr. Michael Finkelstein, author of the book, The Slow Medicine Doctor, founder and executive director of the Slow Medicine Foundation, and the founder and medical director of Sun Raven, the home of Slow Medicine, a wellness center located on a farm in New York. Dr. Finkelstein is a medical blogger for Dr. Oz, Hair Care, the Huffington Post, and he's the author, as we said, of a number of different books. But the book today we're going to focus on is Slow Medicine. Doctor, thank you and welcome to our program.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us a little bit about your journey through medicine. You know, most of us have gone through our traditional medical training and become internists or pediatricians or subspecialists. And you, however, have not only done that, but have moved into something called holistic integrative medicine. So tell us how you got there.
Well, you know, I started when I was seven, when my grandmother told me that she thought it would be a good idea if I became a doctor. And in 1967 at that time, you know, when you think of medicine and science in general, it was really a major upswing after the World Wars. People were heading to the moon. Antibiotics were treating common infections that would have previously killed people. And so there was a lot to be said for the growth and development in medicine. And I wanted in on that. It was really a wonderful opportunity, it seemed. But by the time I got to medical school and graduated in the 1980s, then the healthcare landscape had really changed. And while I was able to practice internal medicine, which was my training, and I thought did a pretty good job, I realized that Western medicine had its limits. And often the attitude of physicians was limiting to people, meaning they weren't encouraged or given great advice from doctors anyway as far as how to take care of themselves. And I learned the hard way. I had to take care of myself. When my blood pressure started to go up and my ulcers started to develop, and I asked myself the question that my patients were asking me, which was, isn't there something else? I didn't want to take medications. At that time, I was the medical director of a hospital. And so, coincidentally, somebody gave the hospital a gift. This was 2001, to build an integrative medicine clinic in a suburban area outside of New York City. And 2001, not many people knew what integrative medicine was, so I was tasked with the job as the medical director to find out what integrative medicine was. And when I did, I started to study with Andrew Weil at the University of Arizona. I realized that integrative medicine holds a great promise, the idea that there are many other systems of health and healing, and if they could all be brought together to bear on an individual who has a life and a condition or a set of conditions, we can do much more than what the Western medical model offers. And so I embraced it fully. And I ultimately opened that integrative medicine practice. And the more I practiced integrative and holistic medicine, the more I realized that we needed more of that. So I closed my internal medicine practice and I shifted almost entirely into integrative holistic medicine and moved my practice from a clinical environment, meaning a hospital, to a farm, where the world around me supports the recommendations.
As you look at and approach health, you know, many people have systems. I've looked at some of your work the problem has always been for traditional physicians understanding the importance of spiritual health, understanding the importance of the role of non-traditional health as it understands the body and it understands disease. Do you see that over the last several years, as you've taken this path, so have many Americans?
Yes, I think, you know, the information technology, the global expansion and connections through the internet has allowed people to share their stories, and with that, their experiences, particularly on how they do and how they approach health questions. So there's been a simultaneous expansion in not only the awareness of what alternatives there are, but how people actually go about doing it. So it's a very exciting time. And as I said, in 2001, when I started my studies in integrative medicine, very few people knew what integrative medicine is. Now, 15 years later, I think it's pretty common for people to ask the question, what would an integrative or holistic approach to this be?
When you start to think about how people get to understand the diseases, what are some of the misconceptions people have about wellness and disease that allows you to take advantage of some of the some of your understanding of how this all these various disciplines and how integrative medicine comes together to solve problems?
You know, I think the first question is a fundamental one, which is, what is health? You know, what is it that we're actually trying to accomplish? We might know what's not health, meaning when we're suffering from a disease and feeling poor, but what is it that we're actually trying to achieve? And health is, therefore, you know, in that way of looking at it, not just the absence of a disease, because there are many people walking around who don't have one that they know of at the moment, but they're not feeling particularly well. And that's reflected in often how they feel when they wake up in the morning, a little down, a little unenthusiastic about the day ahead of them, meaning their work may not be as meaningful and valuable, or their relationships may be challenging. They just may not know where they're going. And so health, to me, needs to be defined so that people then know what it is that they need to do. And in that way, health is an amalgam of what goes on in our physical bodies, but what that physical body is doing in the world around us, meaning in a relationship to other people, the world itself, our communities, and even something greater like what is our life's purpose in the world we're living. So health, that type of health is achieved with a different set of, you know, variables and tools, and requires a different type of attention than just fixing the ailments of our physical body.
Yeah, well, that certainly leads to the question as to what some of those tools are in terms of how we go about where we're fixed in terms of our health. So often it has to do with our culture, has to do with our, you know, our families, has to do with a variety of other things. How do you approach the problem of understanding health? I mean, how do people start to understand their own health?
Well, you know, most people, when I start to explore those with, you know, that question with them, get it right away. That's, you know, they sort of say, oh, that's why I've been doing all these things and it isn't enough. They're not connecting the dots. Often they live in silos. You know, they go to the gym, they go to church, they eat the right food, but they're not connecting the dots among them. They're not seeing that the quality of their relationships may actually be the best barometer for how they're doing. That they not only need a body that can run a marathon, but they need to be able to sit at a dinner table with their friends and family and get along. There's a different approach that's required when you look at the two possibilities. Again, our world, particularly in the West, is fixated on the material, on the physical. And while that's very valuable, I don't think you can really achieve a state of health without taking your body along with it. It's not enough by itself. A lot of the health advisors out there, even in the fields of alternative and holistic medicine, often fixate on the body. And I think, in fact, people's lives are lived in their mind, what their experiences, what their thoughts, what their energy is. And the body, again, is part of that, but it's not all that's determined.
When you start to think about that, though, it's still hard for many people to not compartmentalize these elements as, and many even in some cultures, not to see them as part of the health equation.
Right.
Now, how do you get them there? I mean,
yeah. Well, you're right in pointing that out. I think that's fundamentally challenging when we're raised in this culture, which is, look, just fix it, and you'll have more time to worry about, you know, what's on your mind later. To start in answering the question, most people have had the experience of trying to fix the body. And where are they now? Most people are suffering with a chronic illness, which is why the subtitle of my book is Hope and Healing for Chronic Illness. Despite the fact that you go to great doctors and maybe even chiropractors and acupuncturists, your body still suffers. And your life is somehow inhibited by that suffering. So people have had their own experience of trying it that way. So I sort of ask people then, would you think continuing to do it the same way is going to wind up with a different result? The answer is obvious. So here's the answer to the question of how I help them. Then I give them a set of questions. In fact, my book is predicated on these 77 questions that I've worked with a colleague to develop. And they help a person see the different facets of this diamond of life. Questions might include, interest in aspects of our body, like, you know, whether we move our bowels every day, whether we have enough energy, but they also have to do with our relationships, our spiritual life, our thoughts, and our feelings. And the questions more or less help people take an inventory, almost assessing how they're doing in these different 77 facets with the, you know, premise that refining the response and the value of each question's answer gets us closer to a state of whole health. And so let's say you don't have a great relationship with your parents. That's one of the questions. Well, you can't necessarily fix it entirely, but you can move it in maybe a little bit of a better direction. You can also drink a little bit more water, and you can also get outside in nature a little bit more. And maybe in these 77 questions, you just tweak them. There's no major changes. You just tweak a lot of them. All of a sudden, the synergistic result is one of somebody feeling healthier. At the same time, they're getting the message from me, which is that health is dependent on a lot of these things, and that our answer isn't just to eat a perfect diet or to exercise the way our cardiologist tells us to exercise, but it's a way of connecting those dots, and that's a process. And in some ways, there's a challenge to it, but there's a fun quality to it. This is not all homework and assignments and deprivation. This is moving closer toward assembling this jigsaw puzzle and getting to see a beautiful picture.
We're talking to Dr. Michael Finkelstein.
You know, it depends. If you ask my grandfather, he would say Stein. If you ask my father, he says Steen. So you decide.
No, you decide. This is your job.
I say Steen.
Michael Finkelstein, it's the same. My name is Lenoir, and by the time I found out it was more properly pronounced Lenoir, too many people knew me, and I couldn't change to a more sophisticated version.
So we're both Michael.
So, you know, that's right.
Sort of simpler.
But he's the author of the book Slow Medicine, Hope and Healing for Chronic Illness. And looking at, you know, one of the things we talk about here on About Health is being organized as you move into the healthcare system. We're very concerned about healthcare disparities and not just health disparities, but healthcare disparities and the way people are treated in the system. And so giving them some tools to, you know, use as they go into the process. Now, I imagine that people who come to see you on the farm are a bit more prepared for these kinds of questions and to receive these as part of a health system. How do you find that this applies to like people who are just, you know, often just coming to you without a prior knowledge of self and how important other elements of health are in both keeping them healthy and in managing disease?
Well, that's why I wrote my book, and I have a website which has a lot of the content on it, because people start from different places. It's true. Some people are more prepared than others. A lot of people are quite frankly resistant to talking about something other than their physical body until their physical body feels better. And I'd say that's a lot of people, especially those with severe pain or very scary life-threatening ailments. They don't necessarily feel like they have the luxury of time to pontificate about an approach. And I get that. So my work is, although I think it's very useful for those people too, is generally speaking going to appeal to somebody who says, I really want to take more control of my own life. And they've been to other people, and they've done a lot of things, and it hasn't worked as well as they would like. So that what they're prepared for, it's not necessarily knowing exactly what I will do, but something a little bit more comprehensive, a little bit more, you know, detailed in terms of those dimensions, because they're getting, maybe they either have heard other people say that they've gotten it, or they're getting a whiff of the fact that, you know, life is a little bit more complicated than just eating a good diet, or, you know, going to a gym 3 days a week or doing yoga. It's a little bit more involved than that. And even though those are all good practices, they're part of something greater. And people are very interested that in exploring the nature of what makes them feel the way they do in this moment. And it's usually pretty exciting. So I've written the book to make a lot of that available, including those questions. And if people read the book or just even look at the questions and say, hey, this sounds like if I went through this with somebody who can guide me and give me some good ideas about how I could tweak these different areas, maybe even identify which ones to start with, that would be really useful to me. And you said it in some of your questions, which is somewhat of a process. And the word slow medicine implies, too, that it's not a quick fix. This isn't something that overnight changes how you're feeling, but you can feel maybe quickly more confident that you're on the right path. And then it just takes time for your body, mind to really move into another place of being. But it is more true and sure that you'll get there if you address enough of the variables.
Yeah, I think that it's interesting as you talk about this, that here again I go back to the compartmentalization of health in our Western traditions, is that we see even people very spiritual people who have a whole different life. This is really a lifestyle change that you're talking about, connected both to wellness and I'm sure effective in many of the chronic diseases that you describe. And I think that you speak a bit about trusting yourself in the health, in this whole health scheme of things. What does that mean exactly?
Well, you know, very often, again, we're raised in this culture, which is if you have a problem, you go to an expert. And I want to encourage people to realize that they're the expert for their own body, their own life. We can go to people as consultants, you know, to help us maybe see things we can't so obviously see or measure or assess. But then in the end, we have to decide what works for us, and we have to connect those dots, and ultimately it's the work for us to do. So that's different than Western medicine. You know, you go to a surgeon, they remove your appendix. You really don't need to do that much when you're asleep on the operating room table. But in life, that's not the case. You know, a good doctor even may give you advice, but you have to then take it to heart and put it into action. And same is true with a more holistic approach. There may be variables that then, like I said, we've talked about, go beyond the physical body, and they go into the mental, emotional space, the relational space, a more spiritual or even a question of life purpose space. Those are the things that people eventually get to when they say, I'm going to take this full on. The results are really quite remarkable. This is what makes a difference in somebody's life, because it's not just about whether or not you have a disease, because at the end of our lives, we're all in the same place. The question is, what's the quality of our life? Can we feel proud of the life we're living, and why wait till the end? This is the time to do it. And when you do it now, actually, your body likes it. The cells of your body like this. You know, you mentioned, just as an aside, that people have these ailments. The common core ailment is inflammation. All the diseases out there, or many, many of the chronic, most popular diseases, heart disease, Alzheimer's, cancer, has an inflammatory component. It's not that they're caused by inflammation specifically, but if we can address the inflammatory component, most of those conditions will improve. And if they improve enough, maybe they don't even bother us so much. So my work is about promoting the anti-inflammatory molecular, cellular function.
Well, you know, I think that there's enough evidence without question that and how you perceive things, and certainly how you learn to deal with your environment, and how you learn to integrate certain elements of health into your I hate to keep saying scheme of things, that your immune system works better.
Yeah.
Inflammation is often a hyperimmune state. And so consequently, I think that what you say about chronic disease is true. Almost every chronic disease that we deal with, if it wasn't inflammatory when I started medical school, it's inflammatory now.
Yeah.
How do you reduce some of the how do you naturally, not, I hate to use naturally, what are the techniques you use to reduce a life full of inflammation?
So we can think of inflammation as being provoked by a number of different things. So one of them, obviously, is a direct injury to tissue is inflammatory. It means that it produces the inflammatory response. That's how it was designed. In fact, your knee swells when you twist it so that you don't use it so much until it can heal fully. You know, so it's a natural way. But as you said, when it goes on and becomes a chronic thing, no longer stimulated by that initial insult, then it's got a cellular function. And so things like foods fall into more or less two categories, inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. Animal products, processed foods, the chemicals in foods, the preservatives, et cetera, are all inflammatory. So that's one big category. But the other big category people tend not to think about so much is what's on your mind can be inflammatory. Just think about, you know, watching the news and hearing about people being hurt, how upsetting that is, and what happens in our stomach. We get queasy right away, meaning we're not going to digest the food that we've just eaten so well. We may get a headache. We may get upset. We may feel tired. So we can see that our body responds to our thoughts. And on that level, on a cellular level, a lot of those thoughts are inflammatory, physiologically inflammatory. If I get angry at my mother-in-law, not only does my face turn red, but blood flows in my body in other places. And if I have a bad knee, then that knee is actually maybe going to throb a little bit more when I'm mad at my mother-in-law. So this is the type of thing that if we can get some control over, it can make a difference. If you wake up in the morning and you're working really hard, laboring in a job that you don't love, or your relationships aren't working out, and you're not sleeping well, all these things contribute to inflammation. So imagine if instead of just like taking the anti-inflammatory pill or even the supplements, you said, well, I'm going to change my, I'm going to work with my mind. I'm going to, these winds will blow in my life, but if I can become a little bit more resilient to them, if I can learn to balance, if I can learn to stay calm in the face of the storm, then my body doesn't respond by this level of inflammation. And then if I happen to have heart disease or cancer or on the way to Alzheimer's or a neurological condition or something, maybe I head that off. Maybe I change what's going on cellularly so these things don't manifest in my life. This is the value of slow medicine.
Yeah, I wonder if you're aware of some of the work with Dr. Mario Martinez, who talks about biocognition and the relationship between the immune system, inflammation, and health. He cites a number of scientific studies that support much of what you say, and also talks about the role that culture plays and other things play in how we perceive health, how we perceive illness, and how we go about curing. To move on to another thing that I think I wonder about as I read your book, many years ago I had a cancer of sort. And for a while, it was kind of touch and go, and then it turned out to be not so touch and go, and so here I am 15 years later. During that period of time when I was initially diagnosed, I made commitments to all these changes. Your life's too busy, you're doing too many things, you need to use this time to be more reflective, more spiritual, and I did that for a couple of years. And then it kind of bounced back so that as I assessed maybe 3 or 4 months ago where I am now and where I was then, much of the commitment that I made to the kinds of things that you talk about to develop a better sense of how integrated thing my life could be and how much better my health would be, it's hard to make a change.
Yeah,
and so I see the system, and I read the things that you say, and they all are certainly very well constructed, and I'm sure you have great experience with success. But I wonder how I could make these changes and keep these changes, given that I already have this life pattern. It's hard for people to change.
I agree with that assessment, and I hear you saying about your own personal story, and appreciate that. Most people have something like that to say, that there were periods of time that they had to adjust, and they did. And then when things got quiet and okay, status quo again, they relaxed a little bit. That's normal. And I would say there's nothing wrong with that. You know, who's to say what's right or wrong in terms of how we live our lives? Most people live pretty long lives and have a lot of opportunities to do things interesting in their life and have relationships and maybe raise a family or be part of a community. And those are good lives. Length of life is important. You know, people talk about it, but I think secondary to the quality of life. So to me, my work is to help people have fun with this. You know, it's about quality to me. So if you could make the adjustments and you actually do them because you enjoy them, let's say you're exercising, not because your doctor told you and scared you and said, hey, you know, you're going to have a heart attack and, you know, you're heading there in next 6 months or a year if you don't do something, so you get scared and you go to the gym. What if instead of that, you just loved walking on the beach and that was your activity and you did that because you loved it? How much different would you feel in continuing that activity after you felt you were out of danger? So I suggest people not just make these changes because they're afraid of something happening if they don't, but that they find those things to do that they really are excited about and love. Piece that method together. Do something interesting as a hobby because you love it, not because you're supposed to have a hobby. Have the relationships with people you love as opposed to people that you don't. Find work that you love. These are the things that we have an opportunity. It's easier to go to a job that you love than one that you don't. And even if, you know, I know there's money and there's other things that people have to think about when they select jobs, and there's limited opportunities, of course. I understand that. But even within those, there may be, if we can just keep setting ourselves up to try to succeed in finding those things, it's easier to live that life. And a lot of changes aren't required, and we can follow, let's call them better habits, that are more conducive to a quality of life. And that's what I care about.
Okay. One of the things you talk about is once you've kind of structured and decided that, you know, to move along a different path, to be a bit more open about the elements of your environment and your diet and your exercise programs, and to try to put this all together, you have a chapter on readying yourself for change. What does that involve?
A lot of people come to me and they have a habit that they want to break. Let's use cigarette smoking as one. Now, most people know that it's probably a good idea to stop smoking, but they're not going to do it tomorrow so easily. And some people try cold turkey, and that works for some people, but it's pretty uncommon. So one needs to be prepared for it. Imagine a life without smoking. Why do I smoke? You know, does it provide an opportunity for me to take a break? Am I nervous? Am I anxious? Forget the addiction side of it. I get that, too. But in preparing to stop smoking cigarettes, one needs to understand, well, what is a cigarette doing for you? And then swapping the use of cigarettes, you know, or fulfilling that, you know, the need with something else. Let's say you need a break every five minutes to take a deep breath. Well, then maybe you learn to practice taking a deep breath without inhaling smoke from a cigarette. These are the preparations one can do, and then they can take the foot off the pedal, the gas pedal, and sort of start applying the brakes. There's a mental, emotional phase and then a physical practice associated with making a substantial change that improves the likelihood of success.
We're talking with Dr. Michael Finkelstein. He is the author of the book Slow Medicine. And we're talking about an understanding of health and wellness and of the manifestation of diseases in kind of a different way. He is certainly an expert in integrative medicine. And while we won't be taking questions this time, we'll try to get through as much of some of the topics in the book, Slow Medicine, as possible. Let's talk now a little bit about the role energy plays and what do you mean by energy and how is it integrated into a system of health and wellness?
So a lot of people don't sleep well, or they wake up in the morning not feeling very well rested. You know, it's a very common complaint I hear. And there are a lot of things that go into how we sleep and the quality of our sleep and how well rested we are. But imagine, you know, you're in whatever state you are now, and you wake up in the morning. Let's say your normal time of waking up is 6:30. How do you feel on an average day? You know, pretty poor, I guess, if you're not sleeping well. What if you're going on a vacation that you've saved up money for years, and this is a destination you've been looking forward to going your whole life, Australia or China or, you know, someplace exotic and interesting, and it's a once-in-a-lifetime trip. But you have to get up to go to the airport at 4 o'clock in the morning. And you do. And you wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning on that morning, let's say it's tomorrow, and you feel great. You have all the energy you need. What's the difference? You still eat the same dinner. You still have the same, you know, mediocre lifestyle and habits. But your energy is very different one day to the next. That's the energy I want to cultivate for people on a more regular basis. And that energy more or less comes out of thin air. It's not because of only what you do in your body, although when you then combine work in your body, work in your mind, work in your spirit with the recognition that energy might be available if you opened up the channels, then all of a sudden that synergistic effect is greater. So when I talk about energy, I'm talking about the thing that makes us feel alive. That's what I want to achieve. And people with diseases even can feel that. If they're doing something that's interesting and compelling, even if they maybe look at their disease, cancer as an example, as a treasure hunt. What am I going to find here? I mean, it scares me. I hate it. It's aggravating. It you know, it's challenging my life in so many different ways. But what if through this condition I might find something that's treasure? In fact, I'm going to be in the Bay Area in September giving a talk for Healing Journeys, which is an organization, which is going to talk about, you know, cancer as an opportunity. But that's the idea, is there's a way to reframe our lives, and as a result, immediately shift the energy.
You know, when you talk about making substantial kind of philosophical changes like this, how important are family and friends and support groups?
Very important. I think, you know, I break down my approach into seven categories. I call it the slow medicine wheel of health, and on the wheel there are seven spokes. You might look at it more like a flower with seven petals. One of those petals is our communities. We, you know, we often think of ourselves as individuals and this is our work to do, but when we're supported by a community, people that really care for us and that we care for them, it adds to the meaning, purpose, the value, the security, the joy of living. So it's very vital. I think that there's two types of communities, though. There are communities that share misery, and then there's communities that share life. And what I mean by that, and I'm not putting the former down, but in support groups often, you know, it's a disease support group, and people gather and they, I wouldn't say they complain, but they're sharing their stories of pain and dysfunction. And part of that, obviously, is very important. They're getting sympathetic listeners and empathy and compassion. They need that. That's a big and very important part of that group. But if too much attention is paid to the pain, the aggravation, how irritating the medical profession is because it doesn't, you know, deal with it well, doesn't treat us well, doesn't consider what we have as something serious, that's an energy. That's a mindset. That's inflammatory. Going to war with the disease is inflammatory. So there's organizations, communities, when it comes to the subject of health, that I think, while they may have some value, community, empathy, compassion, they also add this other element of inflammation. I like communities that are about living, communities that are about, let's find joy now. Maybe we all have, you know, one disability or another, so we're going to spend time together because the way we enjoy a beach is with certain types of vehicles or certain type of assistance, or so we can do that together because we get that type of support. But we're there to enjoy the beach, not to say we can't do it the way other people do it. That, I think, is those are communities that are really valuable.
Yeah, you know, I think that you're absolutely right. I think too often in groups, when we get together with groups of people, they're in various stages of either wellness or illness. And many of them have lost faith in some of the principles that have guided them through the early phase and have had some successes, but now are back in act with active disease. And I do think that in many instances, it's not the right place for someone who is trying to build on their spirituality, gain energy, look at cancer as an opportunity. I've never seen it discussed quite that way. And so I think that I've always thought that you have to pick your groups carefully, and keep a lot of positivity around you, because I think that doesn't eat away, encourages new concepts, new ideas, and doesn't eat away at your confidence as you try to grow in that direction. You say in your book, in one of the next topics that you discuss, as we talked about energy, you say that leads us to the next subject, which is fear of death and the pain of loss. And I was trying to understand how that led us to this.
Well, because when we think of the equation of energy, it's what we have versus what's being taken away. So if we're filling a cup, you know, if there's a hole in the bottom of the cup, then we can keep filling it, but we're not necessarily going to make too much progress. The fear of death is an anxiety that depletes our energy. Obviously, it's a reality. It's something that's important that we will face. But to the degree of which it depletes our energy may have consequences in terms of how we feel today when we're alive. So our culture doesn't do very well with the subject of death, finding, you know, meaningful, you know, comfortable dying process, as well as the emphasis of the life that a person is living now, not just waiting for it to end. So as a result, we grow up somewhat unprepared, a little bit unpracticed with the dealings of our own mortality. I'd like to offer that as something worthy of conversation. And so the chapter in the book is about how can we look at death and come to better terms with it, not state of denial, a new state of denial, not to ignore it, but to see that the question about death isn't one that we resolve because we find a way never to die, but we learn to shift our emphasis from death to living.
So as you talk about that, expand on that just a little bit more. I think many people are obsessed with death as part of what obviously is a foregone conclusion. But how do you overcome that? What are the techniques you can use to overcome that or to change your concept of that? Because that really is the American concept.
Yes, it is. Well, and because part of the American concept is, you know, if you have enough resources, whether it's science or the money that allows you to buy science, well, you can ward it off. Yeah, you can a little bit, maybe. You know, there's true socioeconomic differences mean people have different access to health care, and there are different life expectancies, and that is a reality that we have to face and address as a nation, because that's not comfortable, that's not acceptable. But beyond that, the fact of the matter is, the greatest control we have is not just waiting for to have access to better doctors and hospitals so that when we get sick, whatever, is to shift our attention to life, not life based on materials, but life based on the quality of our relationships. That's where community then gets us back to the answer. So the idea is, let's say you have great relationships with your family, meaning your spouse and children and parents and sisters and brothers and your most close friends and family. That's your community. You're living your life. Every day, every Sunday, you go to a park and you play. Every holiday, you gather together and it feels good. It's not something you don't look forward to, as I hear so often. So you cultivate this quality of community. You get people sitting around together one day when they're sober and, you know, thinking about the same thing you are, which is, can we elevate the quality of this gathering on an annual basis, on a weekly basis? And you find a community of people who cooperate and will really pay attention to that and be nice and compassionate and supportive and non-judgmental. And that's the life you live. You have this community. A person who has that type of community in general is less likely to fear death, to fear separation, to fear isolation, to fear being alone at the end of their life. Because every day of their life is filled with that type of connection and the positivity of living, the verb living. It's not counted in days. It's measured in the quality of today. And so that, I think, is the answer, which is it's not more teaching. It's not more theology or philosophy. It's a practice of living.
Yeah, I think that I still am stuck on the fact that these changes are very hard to make. I mean, you have the family you have. You know, I happen to come from a family where if all of us get together, my girls and the grandkids, somebody's going to have destroy the whole afternoon with some unnecessary thing of the past, and it's not always a positive experience. And I just think, talk about some of your successes in making, these changes are hard changes, and some of them are external and which you have very little control, it seems like you have to make them in order to travel the path toward good health, regardless of what your philosophy is. But they're hard changes to make.
They're very hard. And so the first thing I would say to that is it's not necessary to think about a lot of change or a major change. Just how about a small adjustment? What about just one for now? And that's where the 77 questions come in. There are 77 different first steps, potentially, that I offer. 77 different ones. It's not like you have 77 projects. You just have 77 options. And you start with one. And it could be the easiest one. And then after you do that one well, because some of them are pretty easy, you eventually get to things that are somewhat moderate in difficulty, and then eventually down the road to more difficult ones. But along the way, as you do this, you turn off that sympathetic nervous system's fight or flight anxiety response and live more in the parasympathetic, the slow, and the quality of your life will shift. It's not because you're thinking I'm making major changes is you're just doing one thing at a time. And in the process, I keep reminding people to enjoy their life and not to be so distressed that there's a lot more work to do, which often gets on, you know, in our minds and on our backs, and often leads people to say, I'm not even going to get started because it's just so big a problem, I can't even begin. One step. Get outside every day for 5 minutes. Wake up in the morning and actually kneel down and say a prayer. Before you eat, say a prayer. Write a letter to somebody who you want to restore your relationship with and just say, look, it's been a long time. I just want to restore the relationship. That's it. Those things pieced together over time is the process. It's a plan. It takes little effort along the way, and eventually the synergy of it is pretty profound. I believe very strongly in slow medicine. I believe that that's different than we're going to just wave a magic wand, or we're going to give you the supplement you need, or a big pill, or you're going to have a major operation, and it's going to change tomorrow. No, I don't believe that. People have tried that. It doesn't really work. I like the little, relatively easy things to do where fun and joy and love and living are the operative terms.
Usually when people talk about how to approach health and wellness and disease management, and certainly when we talk about how to use our own skill sets to do that, there's always a role. In fact, most of the time when we have these discussions, the role of diet and exercise dominates the conversation.
Yep.
And everybody knows that what we've been talking about this morning is as or more important. But what role do diet and exercise play in a good integrated system of health?
You know, roughly speaking, they're important, but maybe collectively no more than half. You can have a perfect diet and exercise every day and still have a crappy life. So, and I've seen that many times, and so have you. And I've seen people who have a crappy diet and have a very good life. So most people know this, and that's why so many people get irritated with the idea, the instructions, the suggestion that if you don't have the great diet, you can't possibly have it. And so I'm not one who's going to say ignore your diet, because my grandmother never cared about her diet and she lived to be 93. I'm not going to take my chances with that. I think there's the diet approach, though, that I advocate is think about the quality of your food. Think about just like the quality of relationships. Think about the quality of your work. It's all about quality. So am I eating the highest quality food I can eat right now? Because I'm going to know that all that quality that gets put into my body, all the quality of thoughts, the movies I watch, the music I listen to, the people I read and listen to and entertain, thoughts and ideas and words, are those quality. And I realize if it's all quality ingredients, I'm going to have a quality life. If some of those ingredients are crap, then what am I going to expect? So food is a lot about quality, the question of quality. So I go to farmers markets. I want to know where this food comes from. I want to see its color. I want to see its vitality. That's the most important thing for me. I want few ingredients. I don't want to buy foods in boxes or in cans as much as possible. And most people can make a shift in that direction. When it comes to exercise, I prefer the word activity. And so exercise to me sounds like it's a prescription from a doctor who's going to scare you, because if you don't do it, you're going to have a heart attack. And that to me is not the reason to exercise. I want you to do something you love. So let's say you love to play tennis. Good, play tennis. You love to climb mountains? Climb mountains. Ski? Ski. You love to go fishing? Fish. Bowling? Bowl. I mean, there are all sorts of different ways we can be active. I have a garden on my farm, and that's our fitness club here. People come here to work in the garden, and it's moving their body. It's out in the sun. They're connecting to each other. They're doing something creative. Their hands are in the dirt. They're eating amazing quality vegetables at the end of the season. I call that healthy multitasking. It's combining all those dots of the slow medicine wheel of health, and that's how I would reframe exercise and diet.
You know, what's interesting about the slow medicine is that it really is a prescription for the health of most people. I think one of the things that that always intrigues me is that why do we have to be so old before we start to integrate these kinds of things in our system of health? For instance, when I give the example of infant feeding, when we are probably as advanced as we can be in the area of feeding, as we talk about breastfeeding babies and then transitioning them to a formula, if you do that after a certain period, But that period between 2 and 5 is a mess. And so that most people, when they come out of that, when you go to, like I always say, a 5 or 6 year old cannot drive to McDonald's. Somebody has to drive them there. And so that they learn those habits once we get out of that structured period from parents. What if, in looking at something like slow medicine, we started to give these kinds of information to younger people and to our children? That to me seems to be an easier way to make that transition than to try and teach an old dog new tricks, I hate to put it like that. But and I don't see very much of that. Do you?
No, your observations, again, I think are correct. We live in a fast world, fast food, quick fixes. So if you don't have time to prepare food for your children, you're going to bring them to a place and get something already made that, you know, you can eat and, you know, with one hand while you drive. This, to me, is part of the disease of our culture. So in order to shift that for ourselves and for our families, we need to behave differently. We need to make different choices. And as a result, I think we need to maybe start at the dinner table, start around the subject of food, by considering the quality of the ingredients and the quality of the mindset when they're prepared and then they're consumed. It's a slow go, but that shift, let's say you do it once a week. Let's say it's a Sabbath meal, which is done all over the world. I mean, a lot of people work 6 days a week, you know, maybe sometimes 7, but people who work 6 days a week don't have the luxury necessarily of preparing dinner every night. But maybe one day a week you do. And maybe that's the day you bring your family around and you go to the farmer's market and you buy a couple of ingredients, or you pick the, you know, rosemary off the back bush of your, you know, hanging out the window of your apartment. And then you put that into something and you sit down and everyone turns the cell phones off and you spend a minute just being grateful, not just on Thanksgiving. And then you sat there and you say, I'm very happy to be doing this together. And once a week you have that meal. That's the change that I advocate. For most people to begin. And with that, if millions and millions of people started to do that this week, I think we'd have a different world pretty fast.
Yeah, I want to ask you about that in just a minute. I think the point I want to emphasize, and you did certainly comment on that, is that we don't really teach our children that there are other elements of health that have to do with some of the tools that you have mentioned here. Certainly appreciating nature, integrating your spirituality in with your health, and really not just saying it, but appreciate the fact that how you deal with that certainly has to do with how healthy you are and how well you deal with illnesses. Other pieces of, you know, involving family and getting positivity around you, just the tools that you mentioned as you ask these questions in the book Slow Medicine, I think if we started to give those to 4, 5, 6 year olds, at the end of the day, we may have a much different environment for health in this country, although I see some movement in that direction.
I agree with you. I think it starts with our emphasis on raising children. They're the future, of course, but even the practice for the adults in the room, it brings them into the slower, more connected world of those relationships and that role as say, an elder. You asked the question, why does it take so long for people to get it? I think it's interesting. There are different phases of our lives, childhood being one and then older adulthood being another. And in between is this sort of very, you know, intense period of life where we're having our own children and we're working really hard and it's very productive. Those people are, you know, at the cut in between those two phases of childhood and being older, and it's somewhere in there where most people get it. They realize that it can't just be about working hard, that there has to be a reason we're working so hard and a quality of life and a legacy that we care about. So usually midlife people start to think about this, or earlier if they have a medical health crisis or something goes on in the world around them too close to ignore, then they start waking up. I think collectively, though, we are waking up. We're seeing stuff going around in the world, and whether it's happening in our own backyard or not, we're aware that something needs to be done a little differently. And to me, it starts with dinner. Dinner in your own home once a week, that way. Thanksgiving every week. That, to me, would be one fundamental change if we did, would really shift the emphasis and make a substantial change on a cultural level. And, of course, it has a lot to do with our children, but we're in the room, too. So we are the beneficiaries at the same time.
Just to digress a bit, with all the stuff that's going on now, I mean, violence just about everywhere, the news filled every day with a different tragic event, what are you saying to telling parents to talk to their children about, to explain to them what's going on? Because you look now at the last 2 or 3 weeks, there's not one day that goes by, and just as you kind of settle in with one major tragedy, here comes another. What do you tell parents to talk to their children about during periods like this?
I think there's a couple of things to relate. One is to put the whole thing into context. You know, the world is precarious, and there are reasons to be, you know, to have concern and to be careful and maybe even to, you know, to be on the lookout. But the other is two very important things that I think really need to be more emphasized. One is compassion. People are being hurt, and the people who are perpetrating crimes actually also are hurting. You know, we could judge and we can say good, bad, but the idea for me is compassion. These are symptoms of people in pain. And what can we do? And the response to that is gratitude. Is to accept, you know, some things that we can't change, but to say these are the things around us that I really value and I really care about. And one of them is the cherished relationship we have with each other, the people we love. And if we could just keep reminding ourselves, children are reminded they are loved, they have a home, they are cared for, even though there, you know, there's storms out there that are blowing, that they're going to be held safe. That child is likely to grow up and not be one of those individuals who commits such a crime, has felt the compassion earlier in their life, and maybe has the empathy to reach out to those people who are suffering and start this healing process that we so badly need.
You pretty much covered this, but in your final, one of your final chapters, you talk about embracing the future and living skillfully. Discuss that a bit.
Well, you know, I think these are, when I read a book years ago, Eckhart Tolle's New Earth, he, at the beginning of the book, discussed the word sin, you know, a word often used in religious context. But he said the word sin was not originally a religious word. It was a Greek word that was used to mean missing the mark, like an archer who missed the target, to live unskillfully, he said. And I saw that, and I said, gee, you know, somebody should write a book about living skillfully. What are the skills we need to live well, not just as individuals, but collectively? And that's what I set out to do as a result, and that's how my book was born. And so what I mean by embracing the future, living with skill, it's about taking this now and applying them. And even though today may feel like there is a little bit too many challenges to handle and people feel overwhelmed, they're actually in pain, that there's something to look forward to. There is hope and healing in the future. And the way to get there is not wishful thinking, and it's not quick fixes, and it's not looking outside of ourselves, but it's to just take some basic fundamental steps, connecting some of these dots and moving in that direction, starting with our own internal landscape, our thoughts, our feelings, how we apply our attention, what we do in our own homes. And it sounds almost too simple to be a solution for something that's so great, but I think there's no better way of doing it. And so the end of the book is trying to say, look, just get started. Just find one way to start. Believe in something like this, not necessarily my book, but in a process where if you just reorganize, if you make just a little bit better choices, not all of them, can't stop smoking tomorrow. You got to get prepared. But if you start moving in that direction, one day you will no longer need to smoke, you will feel great, and you will have learned something through the period of time where you were smoking and you were dependent on something else. You will be able to reflect even back in the past and say, you know, I'm sort of grateful that I had to do that because I've learned so much. If we can live our lives and then at the end of our lives look back at it and say, you know, I lived a good life, I learned something, I contributed, to me that's a quality of life.
All right, you know, our hour has gone by so quickly. Dr. Michael Finkelstein, The author of Slow Medicine. We really appreciate you taking the time to join us here on About Health. I think that this book is extremely informative. I think the pace of the book really, suggests that it will probably be a more successful strategy than some that we've seen that expect people to make these wonderful changes overnight. I think there are many elements in the book, and you've explained that we don't really have to, you don't have to start, you know, doing all 78 things or even discussing them, but that you start slow medicine. And so we want to thank you. Could you give people some information about how they can connect with you should they want more information about what you're doing, or they want to look at over some of the other publications that you have?
Yeah, sure. The simplest way to find me is the website, slowmedicine.org. O-R-G, and on there are a lot of things that I do here in Bedford, New York, but also my travel and a lot of things that I have written. I have a radio show called Slow Medicine Radio, and the audio for that programming as podcasts are available as well. And similarly, I have these discussions with people who are thought leaders and have something interesting to say, because to me it's about normalizing the state of angst that we have, which is, you know, we're a shared humanity here, and we can help each other. And so slowmedicine.org is the website. It also is connected to the foundation, the Slow Medicine Foundation, which I've set up so that I could get funds to support my work, to reach out to those people who would not otherwise have access, meaning they can't afford them, they can't travel. So we have dedicated ourselves to the broader community in that way. So love to hear from people.
Yeah, and tell us where you'll be in the Bay Area.
I'm going to be at El Camino Hospital, which is in Mountain View, and September 23rd and 4th, giving a couple of talks, one to the hospital, Grand Rounds, the medical staff, which is for the medical staff only, but then that the following day on Friday the 23rd and then the 24th, a free lecture, and then a weekend workshop on Saturday the 24th, both in Mountain View. And with Healing Journeys is the organization that I'll be working with, which is primarily for those people who have been suffering with cancer of one form or another, or have friends or family, or all of us have a concern of that disease condition. And these principles are applicable to everything from cancer to heart disease. It's just the difficulty living our lives at this time in the world, as you mentioned.
All right, well, thank you so much, Doctor, and thanks to those of you who are listening to us today. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenoir. We'll talk again next time.
To celebrate World Poetic Traditions on Saturday, September 10th at 7 p.m. at the Humanist Hall, 390 27th Street in Oakland. For 15 years, Rumi's Caravan has inspired audiences, weaving together poems by Rumi, Hafez, Machado, Rilke, Yeats, Mary Oliver, and many others in an improvised poetic conversation with musical accompaniment. Moving through moods of prayer and grief to humor and celebration, the caravan always highlights the beauty of the spoken word. This performance benefits the Middle East Children's Alliance, who have been providing food and education to the children of Gaza for 25 years. For more information, call 650-327-5493 or visit rumiscaravan.com.
Your donations have allowed KPFA to continue to broadcast a full schedule of locally produced arts, music, in-depth news, and public affairs programming 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Unfortunately, we may not be able to continue as a full-time operation. In recent years, KPFA has lost the Corporation for Public Broadcasting Funding and other outside funding sources that subsidized our finances. These issues have kept our budgets constantly in the red. We've already begun cutting positions and reducing working hours. If we continue continue down this path, this historic community radio station will just be a shadow of itself. We want to avoid at all costs any days without KPFA. We need your help. We're trying to cover a $50,000 shortfall before our fund drive begins on September 7th. Please join the community of supporters who want to maintain this independent media voice. Please donate today online at kpfa.org. No donation.